people a platform to share their views and ideas and ambitions about how to co-create the future of our region that we all share. And also we would like to communicate these ideas and ambitions that we're going to discuss here with decision makers. So I hope some of them are in the audience, even though the audience is not very big, but still. So I would like to see this panel as a follow-up of yesterday's panel, the Nothing Without Us, About Us panel. I don't know if some of you have attended, I think so. Yes, this panel here is organized by the Baltic University Program, short BUP. There are also two representatives in the panel as panelists here. I'm also from the BUP. My name is Mia Weidenschaft. I'm German. And yeah, my friends are going to tell you more about the Baltic University Program, what it does. Also, you will find a flyer here that tells you things about it. And if you don't have it, you can have find this sheet over there. It says, it has the panelists on them, and also the UN Sustainable Development Goals, if you're not familiar with them, because we will address them for sure. So now I would like our panelists to introduce themselves and their sending organizations, and tell us what are your members most concerned about when it comes down to the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals of the UN. So please, maybe Tim and Matt, could you start?
Sure. Good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you all, of course, for organizing the panel and for the university program and hosting us. My name is Tim Heidel. I'm the co-founder and president of Young European Leadership. Young European Leadership, or YEL, is an international nonprofit organization to work on the empowerment of young people by young people. The motivation for this is that youth is the largest underrepresented group in this world, India. And when you think about it, young people will inherit this world sooner or later, so it's important that young people have a strong voice in the decision-making process in this world as early as possible, meaning now. In our background, maybe briefly how we do this, we have two tracks of programs. First, we have a global delegations program, which means YEL recruits and trains delegations, small groups of people who attend international conferences. For example, you know, all the G20 summits and the G7 summits. There's a annual youth conference to it. And we work with the Office of the President of the European Commission to send the delegations of the European Union towards these youth summits. These are the people that negotiate with their counterparts from the United States, from Russia, or Germany for that matter. They derive a final communication, stand forward and direct it to the state government of the G7. 20 countries, for example, for the EU, for the Junta, for the Europol, etc. We also attend other international conferences, for example, observer status in the UNFCCC, the United Nations Framework for Climate Change, etc. And in the second branch, we organize our own conferences. The biggest one is the UNDP Council, which takes place every year, where we bring young people together from all over the European Union. They again come together in working groups or councils, so that can be on gender equality, it can be on migration issues, any topic which young people deem relevant for themselves and for the European Union. They again drive policy recommendations for, in this case, for the European Union, and then we invite senior stakeholders, for example, the Vice President of the European Commission or the representatives of the current presidency in the Council of the European Union, to receive those outcomes, but also discuss them with the young people so that we create dialogue between generations, between sectors, basically. So these are our two main avenues, and then what we are most concerned about, I think this really is represented in our activities. So young people choose the topics they want to discuss about, for example, the Young People Council. When they wanted to discuss about gender equality, then obviously this is a sign they're very concerned about. And I think looking at the history of our activities, the topics which keep coming up are, I would suggest, quality education, gender equality, as I mentioned, decent work, growth, inclusive societies, and how actors in societies can really work together, so the item of partnerships. And find solutions from a young perspective for how these issues can be tackled, or which items are still not untouched but can be easily fixed by policymakers in the EU or in the national level. That's been briefly, and we can touch base on more of that.
Yeah, first of all, if I have a very low voice, so if you can't hear me, just like raise a hand and I'll try to speak louder. But thank you to the Baltic University Program, the Council of the Sea States, and the 2030 Baltic Unit for convening this important session and bringing this discussion to a very practical nature, because in many panels there is a very general nature where you end up around questions like why youth participation instead of the how and what. So I'm excited to go into those aspects today and give you some examples from my sending organization. So I'm on the governing body of an international NGO called the European Youth Parliament. It's one of the largest educational programs in Europe for intercultural debate and for political debate, and where young people get to meet other young people. We're active in 40 countries, so it's only a couple of countries in Europe that we're not covering. Like we're in Belarus, we're in Azerbaijan, we're in Georgia, we're in all the Baltic Sea region countries. And we are working on non-formal education, and we have a very specific methodology that we work. We have projects called sessions, and these sessions have three aspects. So they have team building, where young people from all over Europe get to know each other, or if there is a Baltic program, young people from all over the Baltic region get to know each other. After that, we divide young people into working groups where they get to work on one specific issue for a couple of days. So together with young people from the rest of Europe, they discuss one topic. So let's say common agricultural policy or fishing policies or regional development cohesion policy, very specific issues, because we in EYP think that youth actually have opinions on all issues. All issues are youth issues. There's not a youth policy portfolio where you can cover one perspective, but young people in our network of over 35,000 people are actually having opinions on these very concrete European issues, the state of the Baltic Sea, and it's important for us that, of course, the results of these discussions are important. We create resolutions and they're debated in something we call the General Assembly. We also have a cultural program, because it's important that what they get out of the experience of participating in the European Youth Parliament is not just the academic part and the topics, but we usually say that in EYP you get to experience Europe and you get to learn about Europe. And Europe is part of Europe is the people and the cultures and the languages. So it's important to stress that part as well. And we have cultural events where young people get to taste foods from other countries and they get to represent their countries. And where we have these events where you can also show your talents, or it's beatboxing or it's poetry slam or singing or whatever it might be. But my personal expertise and experience is in organizational management and in non-formal education. And my personal background is also working a lot with human rights issues, sustainable development, and international development cooperation. So it's interesting how these things can be interlinked and how participation in society leads to these issues as well. Last year, I was Sweden's youth representative to the UN General Assembly, and I worked a lot with the National Youth Council in Sweden. So if anyone is wondering about those perspectives as well, and how young people can be part of the formal processes of reviewing the Agenda 2030, please let me know, and I'll be happy to guide you in the right direction. But for the European Youth Parliament, as I've said, our output is not our resolutions. Our output is the people that go through our events. We're a hub for young, passionate Europeans. So we don't work actively with advocacy. Our best product is our people and our participants. And through our events, these young people become active European citizens, tolerant citizens that learn about Europe and about other cultures. They're problem solvers. They're young. European leaders today and tomorrow. They get skills for life through our long-form educational processes, debating, cooperation, and a lot of other skills as well. So we create these active citizens, and they stay in our organization for some time. But one major concern for us is we teach them about engagement, and then when they go out to the world after going to our organization, and the institutional frameworks aren't really allowing their engagement, and engagement isn't really tailored to young people's needs. After we provide all these active citizens with young people who care about their communities, after they've gone through our process, they still can't be caught by the institutional frameworks or by municipalities, and we're seeing a lot of issues where young people get frustrated because they have all the tools in the world, and then the institutional frameworks are not, even for these very engaged young people, not allowing their participation. Another concern is we're a civil society organization in 40 countries, and so for us it's important that our member organizations have structural funding and that they have opportunities to self-organize, which is not always the case. We're seeing a setback in some even Baltic Sea countries where funding opportunities are decreasing for civil society and youth civil society in particular. And we're seeing that access to, for example, schools is decreasing, where a lot of countries in Europe and the Baltic Sea region is decreasing the opportunity for civil society organizations to engage with and in schools, which is a very important platform for youth organizations, naturally. So shrinking space for civil society, both the legal framework and the financial one, and the funding issue are very important for our member organizations. And then for our members, I would say that they're concerned about every issue and they have opinions about every issue.
Hello everyone, my name is Maria Stronska and I'm a former student international representative of Baltic University program, and I'm really happy to be here and to see everyone on this panel, so I think that we could have already a good discussion today. And for the beginning, I want to say a few words about Baltic University program. Of course, it's a regional network, and it includes 232 universities all over the Baltic Sea region. And actually, it started to work in 1991, so for now it's actually growing every year, more and more. And the main focus of the network is sustainable development and environmental protection, and of course, democracy. So it's realizing through education, actually. So actually, a little bit about numbers. So it's 14 countries involved, Baltic Sea region. And 1,500 teachers and researchers and students were into this network right now. And we have like 14 national centers and secretariats and international board. And the main office is actually located in Uppsala in Sweden. Yeah, and actually what is the main core of Baltic University program is to give an opportunity to students, to researchers, to teachers to gather all together and to sit on the table and to have a conversation, to learn new things. And actually we have during the year different kinds of activities, like for example we could have like summer school, like some kind of conferences that include international representatives of each country, so we don't have only one side opinion, so we could gather and have a dialogue. As well, what is actually unique, we have a sale, and this is a sale for sustainability, I would say. So actually, it's a sale, we have two separate sales, it's one for the teachers and another one for students. So basically, what you do, and you're sailing a tall ship, you're a crew, and as well, you're learning about sustainability. So while sailing, we had a lot of lectures during the day. We had seminars, we have a project work there. So actually, everyone could speak up and just share their opinions in there as well. So basically, when you're sailing, you can actually talk to the people who are working on a ship. So you will be familiar with the systems, you will be familiar how their water supplies are working, and where, for example, gray water went after its usage and how it could be implemented. So youth actually could get some ideas, and they could implement it after all. So this actually the main thing of Baltic University program, so it's an opportunity for everyone. And of course, about concerns, I would say that we had a meeting in Kyiv in this April, so we've been working a lot about SDG, the 2030 agenda. So we had actually more positive view of that, not so much concerns, because actually not everything starts on a governmental table. So we don't need laws, for example, for implementation, for implementing some rules, because I think that everything starts from ourselves, and if we want to use less water or less other resources, so we can do that actually in everyday life. So the major concern is to involve people of all ages and as well youth into this topic, because of course we all here are involved in this, so we are familiar with how everything working, what we can improve, but just common people should be familiar with those ideas, so they will follow this as well, and they would understand the decisions of their even governmental, and they would understand their actions of governmental organizations. So of course it's probably more specific for my country, for Ukraine, so you should get involved people really and explain everything about this plan. So I would say that everything started with personal responsibility. So if each citizen is familiar with what our plan is right now, so youth or people of all ages could do something and impact on the process.
Hello everyone, my name is Sylvester Pomorka. I'm from Poland. I am also representing Baltic University program. Right now I'm doing my master's at the environmental protection on interdepartmental studies at University of Warsaw. My studies includes seven faculties, which are chemistry, geology, geography, biology, economics and law. And except of that, what Maria said about BUP, it is also worth to mention that our network includes also Czech Republic, Slovakia and Ukraine, which is quite unique for the Baltic Sea states.
Levels of youth involvement and also with different kinds of influence.
but we all care about the same thing, right? So what, maybe somebody could specific about what is your experience in implementing the SDGs, if you call them SDGs or not? But maybe somebody could answer to that.
Okay, I can answer. So I will forward to my experience in Ukraine. So for now, I'm involved in a civil network of forum, and we are actually organizing seminars, lectures, and just an ordinary meeting with our people of all ages. So, and what we're talking about is actually what you can do in your own house. So, for example, how to provide thermal modernization, how, for example, to use sources and decrease it easily. So basically, all of those meetings, actually the purpose of all of those meetings is to get the information to the people so they can actually use it in everyday life, so it's really practical. So for example, we can meet with owners, like flat owners, and just provide them with the information about what are the, for example, governmental or non-governmental programs right now, which can they use and which could help them for implementing and protecting their own homes. So it's more about like utility and energetic programs. So it's more related to education than just sharing the information.
The European Youth Parliament doesn't work with advocacy on any of the sustainable development goals, but we have incorporated them in the topics of our events. Last year we had an international forum in Braga in Portugal, specifically focusing on the agenda 2030, and a lot of our topics are directly linked to the sustainable development goals of the UN. This is also a struggle I've had in the past year when I've traveled around Sweden and talked to Swedish youth organizations, and where I basically had to convince them that they were working with the sustainable development goals, because they're using different language than these UN documents or macro-regional documents, but in a lot of ways they're doing what those documents are talking about with different language. So a lot of work is put into translating what organizations do and what our member organizations do to the language of these international and regional documents, because youth organizations in their very nature are working on at least a couple of the sustainable development goals. Goal 16 on peaceful and inclusive societies, building resilience, that's what youth organizations do, that's what our organizations do all around Europe. Right now we have a project called the FASES, focusing on the Eastern Partnership countries in partnership with the German Federal Foreign Office. And Basel stands for Building a Strong European Society, which is resilience building. It's teaching our participants about institutions. It's teaching them about all these other targets and goals of sustainable development. So I think most stakeholders in some way are working on it. It's a matter of translation, and it's a matter of partnerships. So we in EYP are right now looking for, or we have partnered with the OSCE in the past 2 years, for we've organized events with them in Austria and in Serbia, with a strong focus on security, again, SDG 16. And these kinds of partnerships allow us to work more closely on the goals, because they provide
that's pretty common, especially among youngsters.
realize that it is an idea about.
So just a quick check out this. The do you hear everything? Do we need to speak louder or are you fine? Okay, so now let's get more specific on what exactly the content of discussions are for young people and how do we implement things. So maybe Sebastian can tell people on what we discussed on our conference.
The conference in Kyiv, which is happens every year in different countries, we discussed some student ideas for implementation of the SDGs in our country region. And for instance, for the goal 13, climate action, students proposed that we should encourage the something called local energy production, so that households can be like a prosumer, which is both a consumer and a production of the energy. So that households can become more energy independent in our region. Also, students were much concerned about our sea and the things that are underneath of it, like the chemical weapon that is still present at the bottom of the sea. And also some trash that is still present there. We catch up some ideas from that initiative called Ocean Cleanup, which uses natural movement of the ocean to collect the plastic. So maybe this could be implemented also at our sea, sponsored by Sea State, for example.
Okay, and I can continue and add some more points that we worked on. We're actually talking about all the SDGs, but we now just mentioned them, probably the most important that we should there. So as well, in relation and goal 3, good health and well-being, so we've been proposing actually to increase taxation for unhealthy product. So in this way, we can actually promote more healthy product on the market and just motivate people as well to use them. As well, we mentioned were free public activities for including support by municipalities or some non-governmental organizations. So all the people can use it, use or just grown ups or kids, whatever. Yeah. And as well, we talked about that we should include more physical activities in our formal institutions, so people could choose actually what they want to do and do that, and make it like in more choices. As well, we discussed the quality of education program before, and actually what student mentioned that youth should be able to vote at the age of 16. Yeah, so it was the transfer as well. They offered to include more exchange of student and teacher exchange. So in this way, we can have a multi-dialogue in this case. As well, students offered to include SDGs into different discussions of the formal education, so included into the courses, and included as well in English, so students can get familiar with all the terms, it's not only national language. And as well, promote courses which are available online, for example, if there are a lot of courses available online in English, so like if you're not even in the network, you can actually check the information, and there are a lot of researches and practical information that you can use for your study or for your research. As well, we've talked about access to lifelong education for everybody. So as well, we talked about affordable and clean energy. It's a goal number 7. So we thought about increasing taxes for non-recycled actually paper products and artificial fertilizers. So in this case, we can actually provide the circumstances which will influence
somebody in the audience or our panelists would like to comment on that, if you maybe consider our proposal feasible or no, or not.
I have a question, thank you. Thanks first for your introductions and for the answers to the question. I think very interesting. I understand that there are different types of organizations that you are representing. But one of them is actually also sort of a more political type of organization. But generally, I would like to better understand how you sort of transmit all the interesting work that you are doing to sort of policymakers or to those people that in the end, you know, sort of take influence also maybe to industry. But so are you working only among yourselves, or are you having sort of mechanisms that bring what you are to coming up with as results sort of feedback through to policymakers? Because in the end, I think that will make a decision whether you have any influence or not.
Good question. I think that is one of the questions we face repeatedly, because the question is often framed slightly more straightforward and thus asked, what are you actually doing? Are you just playing, or are you actually doing real work? And I'm very grateful for this very diplomatic way of framing. So yes, even though we have events on all continents of the Earth over the last 5 years, and we have alumni coming and going, it's, of course, change doesn't happen overnight. I mean, anybody who expects that our participants discuss something and the next day it's happening is maybe too optimistic. Right? But I can give you one or two examples maybe of what we see achievements in the process and how we implement this. So the first thing is what I mentioned before, the G20 summits and the youth 20 young counterparts. There we sent a delegation of the European Union in cooperation, but in full independence from the office of the president of the EU. So we recruit the delegation, we introduce them to the office, they have a chat before, they present what do they actually have in mind to the chief negotiator of the European Union in the G20, and they have a open dialogue, which happens off the book, so that there's an actual dialogue. Right? The young people go to the summit, they have their outcomes, which they then forward to the heads of state and government, and then they come back, quote unquote, home, and have another follow-up discussion. Now, in these follow-up discussions, there's the first opportunity for real influence, because the discussions take place before the chief negotiator goes back to the G20, and it's possible to suggest to the relevant person, hey, this is something we consider to be relevant from the perspective of the European Union and from the perspective of the young people from the other G20 economies. Maybe it's a point worth stressing. And a more, so that is one avenue. Another avenue is that actually in, I think, 2014, the EU delegation had a concrete proposal when it came to the reduction of youth unemployment. And in 2015, a similar proposal was made again by the EU delegation. And they had been literally quoted in the G20 final outcomes. So that's a success from a rough idea, negotiations and discussions on the youth 20 level, and then implementation on the G20 level. Of course, this doesn't mean that this happens overnight, and then, I mean, this is a goal which was stipulated in the next 5 years, the next 10 years, we want to reduce youth unemployment to that amount. Of course, that's a very slow process, but at least there is a process, and at least there's a dialogue and an avenue for a change. On our own programs, for example, the Young European Council, we had last week a topic on gender equality and social inclusion, as I mentioned before. Again, one of the SDGs, which is often not recognized as actually being an SDG. There we invited the director of UN Women in Brussels. She received the outcomes, we discussed the outcomes, and afterwards she invited us to the UN high-level panel on exactly this very topic, where we could again present the outcomes in a much more senior setting, so to speak, such that they influence the discussions, which are then brought forward to the Secretary General. We work on the European Solidarity Corps, so more on goal number 8, decent work, and also related to growth and education institutions. Well, we invited the Vice President, Ms. Georgieva, who in the end was responsible for this portfolio of the European Secretariat Corps. She again received the outcomes, again we discussed the outcomes, and then our mind from the participants, the recommendations traveled into the European Commission, into the relevant units, such that when they discussed in the units what's actually, how the program should actually be implemented, that this is being taken into account. Again, I need to stress that this is not something that we say we change big politics today, but it's at least the voice is being heard, at least there's some influence, and it's a step forward.
Yeah, so,
or,
yeah, so the European Youth Parliament is a platform for young people's ideas. In a network with 40 countries, it's very difficult to agree on a set of issues, and I'm sure you all recognize this, that you're all behind. So we're really channeling the ideas by our participants. We have 600 events every year with 10 working groups or committees at all of these. So that's 6,000 resolutions a year. If any of you are interested in reading those, then I would gladly send them to you in a zip folder. We have three flagship events every year called International Sessions, where participants from all our member organizations participate. The resolutions from those sessions we send to commissioners and to MEPs and to members of parliaments. And we also do encourage our member organizations and the project managers for all our events to send the resolutions to relevant stakeholders. Sometimes that is companies, sometimes it's the municipality, sometimes it's members of parliaments in your own country, sometimes it's someone at the European level, be that Council of Europe or the EU or the OECD or the OSCE. There are so many stakeholders, but we are really trying to encourage all these resolutions to be sent to politicians or decision makers in some way. And then we also have format where we invite decision makers to our events so that it becomes a dialogue between the young people and decision makers. And we invite experts. This year we initiated a partnership with UNHCR both to receive delegations of refugees and stateless people from UNHCR and for them to come with experts and hear about the opinions of other young people at our events. And we're doing this, the similar thing with the decision makers at the European level, where they come to our international events at these and sit in these committees with young people and hear their ideas. But it's very difficult to channel so many tens of thousands of participants' ideas in a very streamlined way. So if anyone has suggestions of how to do that, if you have suggestions, we're open to hearing them.
Yes, thank you. Well, like you say, it's not easy to find a mutual agreement and so on. But on the other hand, I think I'm actually quite lucky in this case because already in our board, many of our members are actually decision makers in their countries because it's a board consisting of mainly grown-up politicians and bureaucrats. So, for example, our chairman on the board, he is also the chairman of the Eastern Norway County Network. So already in our board, we have important decision makers. So when we then agree upon something in our board, then these decision makers or the one working close up to decision makers in the regions can take back our discussion to their home regions and say, no, this is what the BCC is concerned about right now. Let's do something about that in our region. So yeah, we actually have very direct influence on that thing, so I think that's really it. Like I said, we don't always
trying to get better on that is actually very similar to the role of youth and support. I think that young people have a say on basically anything. There's nothing that young people do not have an opinion about or should not have an opinion about. And it's really who is going to inherit this world today or the latest tomorrow? It's young people. So their voice should be heard, and if they are just turned 18 or 2 days before they turned 18, doesn't really make that much of a difference. And somebody who's 13 can be extremely brilliant and more smart than somebody who's older. So these voices have to be heard, so we can try to actually fix that. When you said the concrete recommendation, actually, I think you can simply listen to, hey, what do you want to do? What is your idea? They say, hey, maybe I want to do this and that. And you can provide a framework and a system of how they can do that. For example, maybe they simply like financial means or some sense struggle. I think we are all familiar with this, small NGOs, and guide them towards how to apply for funding, for example. I mean, it's not the what they want to do, but more the how they can actually achieve it. Or maybe put them in touch with partners. I mean, we have independent of, we work with young people, so maybe if they have a complete project for, let's say, education, inclusive societies, we are exactly doing this on a daily basis, so let's have a check.
Yeah, building on what you said, I think that our target group is high school students, and they are usually between, depending on the country and how early you start high school, 14 to 16, 17, something like that. So most of our like newcomers are underage. And we have, of course, there are legal challenges, so we work with a lot of parents and teacher school communications. We found that schools are really the perfect platform to engage young people. Because since we're an educational or non-formal educational program, we can become a very good supplement to the formal educational system. So we send young people all around Europe, 15-year-olds, 16-year-olds, and we need chaperones to go with these delegations of young people to be responsible for them. And for some countries, that's just a friend who is over 18 and active in the organization, but something that we're strongly suggesting is that it's teachers or this kind of educational role model to go with the students. So that's one way we've gone about it. Parental waivers, consent forms, chaperones, teachers, and your question about rural areas. We identified five outreach priorities in our own international strategy, and one of them is young people in rural areas. And they are difficult to find because they're not in the typical platforms where you can find young people in the cities, the squares, these public spaces where they're not as common in the rural areas. So once again, I would say that schools are a good platform to engage young people in rural areas because it's a very official public platform that exists everywhere.
Because I totally agree with what you say there, Nora, because I think that you have to start in the small or in the local level, because you know when you are getting a little older like us, then it would be easier to then, you know, when you're over 18 or maybe also over 20, and you study, it will be at university, it will be much easier to, you know, just hop on a plane and go to the other side of Europe, but that's not easy when you're that young. So I wouldn't say that it's better to start at the local level and create a forum where young people can come and speak their mind, and also then to cooperate with the schools, because that's, I think, where it's easiest to find these people. And, you know, then, yeah, and also talk to the school so that they know what this is, so that they are positive on sending their students to your forums and say, you know, here is a platform where it's safe to speak your mind, where you can show up and so on. And then start there and then maybe get someone who is a little bit older or choose some of these that can come up toward the regional level and maybe even national, international later on, but then start in the small in cooperation with the school and also maybe the municipalities. So.
Okay.
somebody in the audience has something to contribute.
Yes, I could. Thank you very much for this opportunity, as for being a part of the European Union strategy for the Baltic Sea region, and being quite young still in this group of people. I think it's great to have this very strong panel. You know, we have a very optimistic also vision on the on everything that is going on, because very very often we work with the issues, forgetting actually who we're doing it for. I'm representing policy area education, which is the part of this Baltic Sea strategy. Within it, so my point is I have a suggestion that you might look into as an opportunity for you. Within the strategy, we have the 30 policy areas with a very different focus. And since you're working with the different thematic groups, there would be maybe an opportunity and a chance for you to reach out to the policy area coordinators within the strategy and come up with a suggestion to meet with them. For example, they have a yearly meetings in the coordinating groups. So maybe there would be a point for you to be a part of those coordinating meetings. You could both come as an observer, so you could just hear and see what's going on in the policy areas, and then in the continuation of this cooperation, you could also have some potential to work within their processes, because each policy area, they have several actions they're working with, which is then a narrowing down of the policy area. And then you have a flagship process where you have a big cluster of projects. So there is a very practical help that is needed, for example, within the policy area education. We have a flagship process on which is called School to Work, where we work with the knowledge platform for needs. We have a knowledge platform for integration of newly arrived refugees. And in each of those flagship processes, we really need the voice of youth, both from the perspective of how we can help them to integrate, from your perspective of the successful part of youth, but at the same time to help us to reach out to them. And I think none of us working within the bureaucratical structure can do it better than you. And the same, if you look at the analysis of this forum, you can see that there is a lot of issues that are addressing, like saving the Baltic Sea. And then it's also very, very valuable to have you within this panel. But in order to be in this panel, I think you should go and start within the policy areas, because this is the straight way to those sessions. So this could be a suggestion for you.
Good afternoon. I'm actually from DGMI, the European Commission. I have been dealing with sea basin strategies, regional cooperation in maritime aspects, of course, and I don't know if some of you followed the Blue Growth session, which started today. So my question to you, because what I see here is that there is regional cooperation from very early. I think this is very important. The youth, the universities get together, and that creates a network already. But how does this connect to entrepreneurship, and how does it connect to business? I mean, are you working also not only in setting up the policy or commenting on the policy that is there, or the sustainable goals, but how do you see your connection to business? Is this something you established already when you have these networks of students, because their real work is waiting for you, and you have established this network, which I think you have to cherish and develop? Is this already happening, or is it something that we can probably promote through your cooperation, which is, I think, very valuable? Thank
you. I can again go first. But I don't want to. Thanks for the question. I think that is another question we actually received several times. Why do we only focus on politics, like your colleagues at the European Commission, and for the Parliament, for example, why we don't have a stronger focus on business? Because in the end, who's on the ground often when it comes to architect of the business who's making things happen or making things not happen anymore. To be honest, it took us a while to actually recognize this ourselves, because we came from this little bit naive view that politics will solve. Then we started to have a stronger outreach business, and what we do is we invite them to also our events, but a different forum, so to again basically establish a dialogue with business leaders, people who work in business, to hear their perspectives on exactly the idea. So again, we present them with, or the participants present them with the idea, say, what are we actually discussing in our event? And they can provide a reality check from a perspective that a policymaker cannot necessarily do, because a policymaker has one agenda or one objective, and a business person faces completely different realities and sees how legal frameworks work actually are implemented in one way or the other. The second, we see business as a not only as an implementer of policies and regulations, but also as a supporter to actually establish those. So what we do is that we reach out to the private sector and say, look, young people are important. So basically what we said here before, we explain them why young people should be listened to and why it's important to have our initiatives. And they we ask them to support us. And thereby we automatically they have some skin in the game and are interested in a follow-up and are listening to what we do. And we can use their platform to actually promote our own ideas. And we can use, to some degree, their name in a mutually constructive, mutually beneficial way. So it's more than a collaboration instead of telling them what to do. For example, we work with it's a very simple thing with a hotel chain in Brussels. We work with them, they work on, they provide the accommodation, and it's in a fostered into a sustainable setting. And we work with them, or they work with us, and provide for example, scholarships for our participants. So it's there we have exactly this form of partnership with just one example.
I have some specific answer for your question. My university in Warsaw, in Poland, this is not common for the Baltics, but we have for the short period of time right now something called University Center of Knowledge and Technology Transfer, so that specialists who work there are connecting scientists with the business, helping them to start establish startups, etc. Since, I don't know, 1 year right now, I have some quite big success right now. The company has been started thanks to this. So maybe that's the one idea for that.
Okay. I want to cover two aspects. One of how the European Youth Parliament is working with the private companies and the private sector, and one other project I'm working on aside from the European Youth Parliament, which is focusing strictly on young people and multi-stakeholder platforms with a very big focus on companies. But what the European Youth Parliament does is all our events are funded by the project managers. So 600 projects funded by 600 project managers. So we are in touch with the local businesses. They're a great both funding partner and content partner for our local initiatives. At the international level, we have a cooperation with the Sparkassen. Really private companies, in some countries where public funding is very scarce, it's the main partners of our events. And we try to get a balance between both public, academia, civil society, and private partners participating in our events, because we also see them as decision makers. And if we want to have some kind of impact by these proposals of our participants, then we need to reach out to all those decision makers in all those different areas. So that's one example, by funding partnerships.
relationships and expert dialogue, very much on the local level. You have this example of a hotel in Brussels. We have that in like so many cities in Ukraine, so many cities in Georgia, in Poland, where there are these local partnerships. And the second initiative I'm working on, which is actually my work, is a project called We Change, which is Sweden's largest initiative for young people about sustainability. And there we are partnering with 40 stakeholders. More than half of them are companies. And we take them on tour with us. So we travel all around Sweden, and we bring these 40 partners, and they organize workshops. So we're not organizing the workshops. We help them create like the structure of the workshops they organize, but IKEA is organizing workshops, H&M are organizing workshops, local businesses in different cities are organizing workshops. So it's a very concrete way for them to hear what young people think about these issues. And they frame those workshops in a way where they get constructive input on, you know, how can IKEA become more sustainable? Or how can this local business working with catering become more sustainable? And they get that concrete input, and young people are engaging concretely in topics of sustainability. So those are two examples.
I suppose you know that many times the 16-year-olds were supposed to allow to be voting. It was, it actually did not happen. But I see this tendency, so you could comment on this, whether there could be some like European level or at some more level to really allow 16-year-olds, maybe even younger, to really be participating and voting, especially if you consider the last situation in Europe, when actually the elderly voters decided mm-hmm. for the answers the other round. So the future will be shaping the 7th class, not really the 14, 15 class, because they were not given the voice. And I just wonder what you would comment on that.
So EYP is not actively working for vote at 16, but a lot of other European NGOs and a lot of national NGOs are working on it. Without taking a stance on whether EYP likes it or not, what I can say is there has been some trial rounds in a lot of countries, in Norway, in Sweden, the democracy survey suggested that voting at 16 in municipalities as a trial round would be a good idea. But it was based around this idea that if young people get the chance to vote at 16 and they show up, then we will continue with it. Which to me is kind of a weird approach to trials, because it should be a rights-based approach we're not going to take away women's voting rights because they didn't show up to the first elections. It's a very weird rationale, in my opinion. But one positive thing I can see with vote at 16 is making young people a political target group. So maybe people that are 16 aren't going to vote until they're 18 yet, but we're engaging them in the formal political processes earlier, and we're ensuring that decision makers and policy is reflected by young people. If young people can't vote, policymakers don't really have an incentive to tailor policy to young people. So I do see that there is a great potential for young people being a political target group and being a political stakeholder, increasing, for example, the possibilities for youth organizations and different stakeholders that I'm working with. But EYP doesn't take a stance, so that's my personal, I think voting at 16 makes a lot of sense.
I agree. My organization, we don't take we also remain very neutral on these items. But again, I also see great benefit that if you are even earlier have the opportunity to actually raise your voice in a formal way, maybe it also drives for even more people a political consciousness and to actually reflect on the issues at hand and maybe become not only active in terms of voting, but actually say, hey, I found my own organization and I'm driving the change. Because I think many people don't necessarily understand or appreciate that they are the change themselves. So there's only so much value to complain about the situation if you just say, hey, why don't I change that myself? We saw that it's something we can do. There's a gap, so to speak, in the market for young people. So we went in and tried to do something about it. And I think if more young people actually become active, even better, because they also have more access to more tools. They're digital natives, even more so than maybe we here on the panel. They have more opportunities. They have a completely different mindset, and they also grew up with the new social norms, which are in the end going to prevail in our societies, because I mean, they are going to live longer than people who are currently in charge. So getting them even earlier involved in a formal or informal process, I think has a great value for our societies. And again, it doesn't have to stop or start with a formal process. I mean, it's also about empowering them to actually do whatever is on their minds, whatever they want to implement, be it their own business, be it their own NGOs, be it an online platform. It almost doesn't hurt. It's about getting active and getting started.
Yeah, I think this is kind of like a hard question, because like you say, we have a neutral form, because it's very many good arguments for having voting rights for 16, but it also good arguments against it. And then also voting, yes, then you decide who will be deciding for the next 4 or 5 years, whatever. And that of course is important, but if we only give them the right to vote, then we don't actually give them any right in saying what these decision makers are actually deciding. So I think that maybe it's even more important than to, as you say, bring them into the process, in the actual processes, in the actual decision making processes, and get the young voice heard there, is even more important than the voting age.
I would say you can do both at the same time. So.
Yeah.
Somebody else?
Sophia Hennesson, recently in the National Coordinator of Sweden. I just want to say that we last year in Stockholm, as you already mentioned, we introduced a youth perspective to the panel session, and we're very happy to be able to do that, since the main theme of the annual forum was the future of the Baltic Sea region. And I just want to invite you to think of how you can further involved in the implementation of the strategy, because I think it's only open doors if you want to be more engaged. And also to echo my colleague on the right on her suggestions on how you can be more involved, because we'll have all these policy area coordinators and horizontal action coordinators, but we also have national coordinators, and all these contact details are available on the USSR website, but most of these people are also here, so you can just grab them and let them know of your interests, and maybe also to take this opportunity to ask you if you have any inputs to us on how you can be more active or involved, or how could the USVs all be interesting for your organizations to be more involved.
I represent Messi, and I would like to know your opinion about possibility for some cons to form a Baltic Sea Council or any structure. Because since some time there is a discussion held on in BCCC, in BSPC, in UBC also, that perhaps it would be good to have not only networks, which work very well in Baltic Sea region on any topic, but youth representation. And I know I can see that your organizations are well structured, and they work very well. We made a project with European Youth Parliament in Stettin, and it was great. And I know that you are very well organized, that you have structure, and this is like So I would like to know your opinion. What do you think? The discussion is sometimes is towards this idea, and then there are also many arguments against from the young people.
Because when you just made the comment about involving young people, I wrote down your experience are youth forum. Then you said, why about a youth forum?
Yeah. We have it in our resolutions and so my resolution, nothing is happening. Because sometimes the young people and youth organizations say, oh, we don't meet because we have a European Youth Forum and on the platform, this is the platform, I don't see here at the panel any of the representative of European Youth Forum. I don't know.
Just another argument apart from, because I would like, first I can say why actually not doing it, because it's the only argument that there's the European Youth Forum, and hence you don't want to double structures.
There's no normal structures, no normal structures, many other.
I have a suggestion.
From the young people, from the young people of a youth organization. So I would like to know your opinion.
First of all, it's great to hear that you have great experiences with your youth forum. I'm happy to hear that. And for the youth forum part, what I see a lot of the times is that when different stakeholders want young people's perspectives, they create something separate instead of channeling young people into the original structures. So that I think would be maybe one hesitation. But something I would suggest is the Council of Europe has an advisory council on youth with a co-management system where young people are, of course, they're working separately and it's youth civil society working, but they're co-managing the structure with the original structure. So it's not something separate. UNESCO, for example, are organizing a youth forum every year, but it's completely separate from the rest of UNESCO's activities. And it's important that whenever young people's perspectives are going to be channeled into the processes, that it's not always a new project. Maybe it's just a new way of seeing how you work with your current projects. So maybe there could be mandated positions for national youth councils or something similar, or specific spots for civil society organizations working with young people or for young people. But I would suggest looking at the advisory council of youth system, it's quite the best practice to have.
I think the idea in itself makes sense to me. I think it's just a question of how you implement. When you said that they'll make a separate project, this is sort of what is a given. You don't want to have but you do not want to create this a separate entity which then has no interlinkages. I think because then you push youth aside and say, oh, the young people do their thing there, and that's it, and it doesn't feature in the overall process. This would be a disaster for the young people, right? This would be really bad. I think what is helpful is to get the young people actually from the Baltic Sea region together. Can be a forum maybe one day before the annual forum. They come up with their own ideas on exactly the same topics, but with their own perspectives, their own topic specifications. And then they simply sit equally on the same big panels. So we have the very nice big plenary room next door. There can be the sessions which take place there. Have also one or two young people there which actually reflect on their own perspectives, plus what had been discussed in the forum one or 2 days before, or can be in a week-long forum with more problem around it, culture activities and youth exchange. So I think a lot of things is possible as long as you don't make it a secluded entity, because then you don't reach what you want to, or you don't achieve what you want to reach. It's mainly that young people are actually having a strong voice and that their opinions, which are valuable and relevant for the region, are being heard. And maybe one more point on it. I think this is especially relevant given the Baltic Sea region's very unique geostrategic positions. I mean, I think Federal Minister Gabriel made the same point yesterday that the Baltic Sea combines rather diverse countries and economic systems and political approaches from, you know, from Germany is one way, then the Nordic countries are maybe another way, then you have Poland, then you have Russia. So you have a very wide spectrum of how things run. So actually invite all, from all these member countries of the Baltic Sea regions to really get all perspectives, because in the end, if you have any sort of problem in the region, the only way for a sustainable solution is actually to bring everybody together, so that brings us back to the whole idea of inclusivity and inclusive societies and inclusive decision making, etc. So getting them involved and then giving them a strong platform on the event itself, which is not a booth platform, but being really inside the forum. And then I think you actually achieve a great deal, and you actually become more more advanced than other similar forums.
I really agree with what you're saying there, that I don't think it would be better to create another organization where youth are separated.
We don't have anything
else. Because we already have many organizations with have youth groups, so maybe that would be better to work further with these, and also that they can meet. Like, for example, Monday and Tuesday this week, we met up the youth groups in the region of the sea, along with Eurovision Baltic and Union of Baltic Cities. And we have a joint meeting where we together planned the workshop that we had yesterday, and Nothing About Without Us. And I think that would be more fruitful, that would be better to create another organization. And also when you do that, you can then, like you say, participate in the actual forum. Like, for example, if there is some panel-based, maybe you need a name area that they can try to bring in a youngster to sit in the panels, for example, have some young speakers and so on, so that we can be more involved in the grown-up forums instead of the youngsters being there doing their thing and the grown-ups being there doing their thing, that we can come together and discuss together.
So no. I can give you a comment. I can give you a comment. Within the Polisario Education, we had one of the projects with the, which was which had a connection to youth, and we had there is actually a Baltic Sea Youth Forum, which is organized in Germany, and they were a separate entity with a separate funding. They were applying on different funds, and I can tell you from the experience that it was very difficult, extremely difficult to have a separate. Separate thing going on. So this model was already tried out. So I agree definitely with it. I think you have a great experience from your organization that it's much better to make it flow inside more naturally within this forum that is already having a lot of possibilities for them. So there is youth forum, and if you have...
No, there is no youth forum as we think.
No.
It covers all organizations and organizations and are somehow connected to politics.
Yeah.
To CBSS, for example, and a kind of umbrella organization.
But this is interesting. I think what is happening right now is very interesting because we can that forum was started by policymakers because they said, we need it. But actually, we hear now what Yus is saying, and we can see clearly that they have a different vision, and I think it's wonderful.
And also, I think that if you connect that up to the first question we got here today, that how do you take your work and pass it over to the decision makers? And we can see that we already struggle with that because not all decision makers want to hear us. We don't necessarily have the platforms to do it. And if we then want to create something that is not even linked to a grown-ups organization, I think that would be even harder to do.
But we can say maybe there is not the forum in the way you are doing it, but Council of Baltic Cities does have the youth dialogue. I think what we can bring home is that we need to improve the coordination of this different levels from macro regional, BSSC, European Multi Union of Autism, so have this multi-level kind of governance also including the young generations, and that's what we can work and improve, I think.
The alternatives are no or yes, then yes. But if the alternatives are broader than that, with some of the suggestions that we perhaps have and other young people here, or if you reach out to national youth councils in the Baltic Sea region, I think you can get quite a good format going where it wouldn't be one or the other. So if the alternative is yes or no, then yes, but otherwise we would suggest alternative ways.
But it's very important what you are saying, because every year in some political organization it is written in their resolutions, we want to support Baltic Sea Youth Forum. So I will go to them and tell them, don't write this anymore. The young people don't want. And this is a very positive message in the end, that, that politicians should listen to the young people, what they want. If they want to have such a structure or not, if not, just stop pressing, maybe.
Or find other.
But we have, we have many structures. I also do a lot of work with between young people and foreign policy.
Yeah, I'm Chris Rees from Avenger. It's an urban development project platform which focuses on youth. I think the point you bring up is very important. I think we as an organization would welcome such a youth forum, but I think it's an opportunity to think about how that forum can provide something a bit more unique or a value to young people beyond, like we just said, another forum for representing youth voices. And we would advocate that that should be based on practical projects. I would rather see another format where you can have real project support for pilot projects for different action research studies, which are relevant to all of the youth in universities and young graduates, rather than creating another advocacy group within your structures. Of course, coordinating what's already there is very important, and then linking that implementation arm into it would, in my mind, be the best solution to provide something unique, and that has impacts, like we heard from the first question from the lady who's left. How do we create impact that can be translated to the policymakers? It's not by talking again on another panel in the big room, it's by coming with real examples, saying we've done this over the last 6 months, showing them what we've done, can you support us further in this beyond the pilot study? Can we link up with private firms who have the actual needs and the problems which can be addressed by that forum specifically, so it's directly relevant to the private market, and then we have this ball rolling of the knowledge exchange, the skills exchange, and all of the good work that these organisations do. I would welcome something more practical on those lines.
So I'm sorry to tell you that our time is up, but this was a very nice discussion. Thank you very much. And I would like to end up with a statement that the only thing in our lives that is constant is change, and it is our choice to get involved in that change and direct it in the direction we would like it to go to. And this is what we just did. So thank you very much for to all of you.